his utter disregard for small business. In 2011, there were a number of critical votes to the future of small business here in Maine and across this country. And he couldn't find a single one of them where he could stand with Maine's struggling small business people. Imagine that, in this economy, with so many jobs of Maine people at stake in small business, he couldn't find one single solitary issue where he could side with the people who are creating our jobs and keeping our economy as strong as it can possibly be. We're going to hold him accountable this year. We as a party have to hold Barack Obama equally accountable for the things that he is doing to this country. Centralizing power in Washington, crippling the states with a health care law that is, you think we have problems now. Yeah. It's state government struggling to keep up with an explosive Medicaid program. Well, we haven't seen anything yet. Because as this law kicks in, we are literally going to be struggling to do anything else that we do as a state. Educating our children, building our roads, the basic functions of state government are threatened to be absolutely crippled by the burdens being placed on states by this all-powerful, all-knowing federal government. We have to turn that around.
Sure.
Maine has a proud tradition of sending people to Washington who have risen to prominence. And whether you always agree with them or not, I think most of us in this room could agree that people like Margaret Chase Smith and Edmund S. Muskie, William S. Cohen, George Mitchell, and more recently Olympia Snow and Susan Collins have become prominent in Washington. On the other hand, we have a congressman who twice has been named by Roll Call, the newspaper on the Hill, as one of the most obscure members of Congress. They said they have trouble finding his name when he speaks on C-SPAN. There's a blank space under his face for a while because they're trying to figure out who he is to put his name to. That's not the kind of distinction that I believe that we want for our member of Congress from Maine. Rather, we need to look to the tradition we have and the heritage we have of sending people down there who have brought credit to our state and have been at the center of solving problems. I can assure you, when I get to Washington, I'm not going to be content to be a quiet backbencher. It is my pledge to you that I will never once be named to the most obscure caucus list. So as we prepare to go into battle, to elect a new Republican senator, to maintain the historic majorities that we were able to secure and all of you helped to secure in the Maine Senate and the Maine House, to elect two new Republican members of Congress, and to elect a new president of the United States. Absolutely. I ask that each of you do as much as you can to continue those gains, to work with us, to remember the ideals that this great party was founded on. As we heard from Professor Hodgkin and as Charlie so eloquently noted, during a time when this country was being torn apart, at that point it was being torn apart by a civil war over the issue of slavery. Today, our country is being torn apart by an ideological battle. A battle that I think the people of the United States didn't understand that we would be facing when they elected President Obama in 2008. But every day, they are beginning to understand it more, to understand what is at stake. And it's up to all of us to make sure that when November rolls around and people go to the polls, they have that message. And they understand the difference. Two great political parties have a proud history in this nation. One of them has gone astray, and it's not us. We can only assure the right outcome for our country and the preservation of the ideals that have made us the greatest nation on earth by uniting behind our nominees and doing everything we can to elect them in November. That common goal that we all have toward a more prosperous Maine and a safe, secure, and prosperous America. As Republicans, it is up to us. Olympia Snow, I think, through her comments, announcing her retirement, has really issued a clarion call. And it's a call that, as Republicans in Augusta, we are already hearing for civility, for treating each other as human beings, even when we disagree. Lois mentioned the positive tone in Augusta. And I think one of the things we can be proud of as Republicans is that we have rejected many of the negative tactics that the Democrats have employed over the years. We've worked together in a civil, constructive way, but we've done it in a principled way, where we have fundamentally changed the direction of this state. It's really, when you think about the accomplishments in just 14 short months, it's staggering. The way that we have shifted the course of this state. You have... You have helped make it possible. And now we need to do for America what we've done for Maine. I want to thank you all for your friendship, for your support. I want to thank you especially for the prayers that I know so many of you have offered in the last couple of weeks when my wife Karen faced a very serious health issue. I can't tell you how much we were bolstered by the kindness and the love and the support from so many of you in this room and others across the state. And we felt your prayers and we felt your love, and they've worked, because look at her now. Thank you very much. God bless you, God bless the Republican Party, and God bless America.
Thank you, Kevin. One thing I know about Kevin I've learned through Garrett is Kevin loves his wife.